because we're going to talk about optimizing the use of data in decision making. And so we've got a good up to 90 minutes or 80 minutes or so for this session, and it's going to be chaired remotely. But first, a word. I mean, people are, it's not just in the context of food systems. It's on a whole range of development areas that people talk about the lack of data for making informed decisions, both by the development partners, the donors, and other actors. And the private sector often say they're reluctant to come in because they don't really know whether the figures that they're going to be making investment decisions on are robust and up to date. And when it comes to decision making on food systems, that also applies. So we're going to talk about that with a range of speakers. We have a keynote, we have updates on data initiatives involving research organizations, involving Series 2030, involving GPSDD. Most of our participants are going to be online, but of course we can be engaged here as well and can also make interventions as well if we catch the speaker's eye. So I'm delighted to invite the moderator of our session. She's going to be joining us online. We'll be able to see her on the screen there. She is the director, the senior director of policy at the Global Partnership for Sustainable Development Data at Columbia University in NYC. And I can see her looking hopefully at me right now. I'm looking straight at the camera. Yes, she is Jenna Slotin. And Jenna, I believe you're going to try and do something. Now, this is a hybrid event, and there aren't many events where the person chairing is remote and a lot of the people in the room are going to be directed by her, but this is one of those. So fantastic. Looking forward to this session very much, very into data as we all are here in this room. So I'm going to hand over to you and let you take it away.
Thank you, Henry, and thanks for having me. We'll do our best. We'll see how we do in this hybrid format. The majority of our speakers for this discussion in this session are online, so let's see how we manage. And perhaps, Henry, I'll ask for your help in case we have questions in the room during the Q&A. We'll manage, I'm sure. So welcome everyone to this session. As Henry said, it's called Optimizing the Use of Data in Decision Making. And my name is Jenna Slotin, and I'm coming to you from the Global Partnership for Sustainable Development Data. We're really honored to be putting this session together today. As Henry said, this is an incredibly important topic, especially as the world is facing cascading crises of climate change, the pandemic, and of course, the war in Ukraine, putting food security under severe threat. As we got started a little late, I want to move really just directly to the speakers. We have a great mix of speakers to discuss this with us today. And we'll be focusing specifically on why data is so important to implementing national pathways for food systems transformation, and what the global donor community can do to support countries to strengthen their data systems, fill data gaps, and improve capacities to avail themselves of new technology and data to respond to crises and achieve the sustainable development goals. So we'll first go to our keynote address, and I'll introduce Joseph Glauber, who is currently the chairman of Agriculture Market Information Systems, AMIS, which we've heard a lot about in the current crisis. He's also the Senior Research Fellow on Markets, Trade, and Institutions Division at the International Food Policy Research Institute. And Joe will focus on why authoritative, accurate, and reliable data is such an important basis for collective action, and how better data contributes to greater policy coherence in crisis response. So over to you, Joe, please. And I'll just say that I'll be merciless on timekeeping. So please, over to you.
Okay, great. Thanks very much. I'm going to share my screen here as we're speaking. Okay, great. I presume everyone can see the screen, and I'll just move forward. Okay, so what I thought I would do is talk a lot about a couple of efforts I've been involved with over the course of my career in terms of improving market information in particular to inform policymakers. Prior to my current position at IFPRI, and I spent 30 years in the Department of Agriculture in the U.S., where I oversaw a lot of the global supply and demand outlook, the monthly forecast that USDA puts out. And what I thought I'd do is talk a little bit about that, the development of that operation, and then talk a lot about AMIS, because AMIS is something I was involved with the establishment back in 2011, and have been involved with it very closely. As Jenna mentioned, I'm currently serve as the interim secretary of AMIS. So let me move on. Okay, doesn't seem to want to let me move the slides. All right. Okay, so I'm gonna wing it here, and because I don't think you really need to see the slides anyway. Let's just stop this. And what I thought I would do is my first, again, I mentioned that the Department of Agriculture, it has been involved. It actually was created in the 1860s, primarily to gather data for farmers. Also did just a little bit of research in development or technological innovation in the sense that it also was responsible for disseminating seeds and other things like that, but it was mainly collecting data. And back in the 1920s, all of a sudden, USDA started thinking about, well, how to provide analysis with that data. And at that point, in fact, in 1924, they held their first Outlook Forum, which an event they've been holding ever since, once a year, where they give an outlook for the next year. And that, again, since the 1920s, and they, you know, they developed analyses through their statistics service. They have a economic research service that does particular studies on demand, on other sorts of aspects of the balance sheet. They have a foreign agricultural service that collect data both within the capitals, but also utilize a lot of earth observation data for forecasts. And these groups were all producing estimates. And, you know, everyone thought that they were doing a great job until the early 1970s, when the former Soviet Union came in and bought a lot of grain. And they bought a lot of grain over the course of about 6 weeks that was really caught the market off guard. And all of a sudden, stocks were very low. Global stocks, price volatility, prices went through the ceiling. It became known as the global grain robbery, not through the fault of the Russians. The Soviets actually came in and were buying grain. It just wasn't known to anyone. And USDA was decided that they needed to do a better job of their gathering information. So they had all the pieces there. It was just that policymakers were hearing from one organization that was saying, well, they thought the crop was X, where another group was saying that the crop was Y. So what was formed was something called the World Agricultural Outlook Board in the mid-70s, in direct response to the grain deals that we saw in the early 1970s. And since that time, they've had a group that meets monthly that coordinates the estimates across the department, and they put those out in a monthly report. And that report has gone on from just being primarily domestic focused, that is U.S. Supply and demand estimates, now to do estimates on, you know, about 15 to 20 commodities of every month. They're put online. There's one can download all the latest data, and it incorporates, again, thinking not only of the statistics service in the U.S., but also through Earth observation data, through foreign countries, posts, and other things is used to gather data. So let me turn from there because that's been available again. I think those world agricultural supply and demand estimates are viewed by some as sort of the gold standard for at least global market intelligence. There are other groups that do it, including groups like the International Grains Council. But what we saw in 2011, was a lot of concern with price spikes that were occurring in the wheat market, but also in the maize and soybean market and rice market was high as well. That was following the price spikes in 2007-08, which had gotten quite severe, particularly in early 2008, when wheat prices in the U.S. went over $20 a bushel, levels, by the way, that we haven't hit with the current crisis in Ukraine. And the rice market was in an uproar as well. And the France, who was chairing the G20, decided to get together and have convene the ag ministers from all the G20 countries. And what emerged from that was this group called the institution called the Agricultural Market Information System, which is composed primarily of G20 members. It does have some significant producers and consumers of crops who are non-G20 members. So we have countries like Ukraine, Egypt, others, Thailand, Vietnam, that are important producers for commodities, but aren't G20 members. And AMIS, the idea with AMIS was to, one, to provide better information. What AMIS does do is it encapsulates in each of its monthly reports, it shows the USDA's estimates, it shows the International Grains Council estimates, and it shows its own estimates for supply and demand balances for four major commodities, wheat, maize, soya, and rice. And I think the idea, at least initially, was that by doing so, it would be able to independent view that countries wouldn't necessarily have to depend on U.S. estimates or other estimates, but they could see all these estimates, and it would help policymakers avoid the mistakes that were made in 2007-08 and 2010-11, when we saw a lot of export restrictions be put in play, and which further exacerbated markets, a lot of panic buying, a lot of excessive market volatility, that the idea is that could have helped been prevented had there been better information for some of the countries involved. And certainly we saw that in 2012-13, we had a very large drought in North America. I think AMIS was very successful in calming waters at the time and convening its own members to at least reiterate that markets actually were functioning well, that despite the high prices, and at that time they were record high prices, markets were functioning well. And we saw far fewer export restrictions and other things over that period. Similarly, during COVID, a number of countries initially put on export restrictions on food products. AMIS met several times during that period, and after about 5 or 6 months, I think most countries realized that markets actually were functioning well despite supply chain disruptions and other things, the major grains at least were, shipments were moving fine. In fact, we had record high shipments for some commodities during that period. That brings us to the current crisis. And I think, like a lot of other international organizations, one of the struggles has been is that we have both members of that war as members of AMIS, and that's made life difficult at times, but I think we have met several times. We had a seminar on export restrictions, talking about what countries are implementing those restrictions. We've had numerous meetings with the technical group, but it's provided a forum at least for members to talk about problems that they're seeing in the trade, be it transportation costs, be it bottlenecks, be it production shortfalls and other things. And so I think actually it's done quite well. AMIS currently is contemplating an increase in scope in terms of, it was mentioned in the previous session about vegetable oils. The vegetable oil market has been very, very hot And so Amos currently looks at soybean oil, but the idea was that it would look at a lot of other oils like palm oil, like sunflower oil, like canola, or rapeseed oil, that are all major, major oils traded in the world global marketplace. And then lastly is expanding analysis to include fertilizer and other inputs that, you know, this Amos is a small group. It has almost almost a negligible budget. The G20 isn't a funding organization, I think, as most people know. And so we've depended on donations from member countries. In addition to the countries themselves, there's a secretariat that composes about 10 international organizations, including EFAD, including FAO, including IFPRI, my own organization, OECD, WTO, World Bank. And these groups all give in-kind support in terms of particular analyses. But again, the idea is that hopefully we'll be able to expand some analysis as we move forward, because as we can see in the current crisis, it's not just the movement of grain, but it also the movement of inputs and other things that are so important. And with that, let me close and can take questions or just participate in the discussion, however you want to handle it. And apologize for the PowerPoint. So certainly can make it available to people afterwards.
Thanks so much, Joe. That was really great. Even without PowerPoint, I think you were super clear, and it was incredibly useful to hear a bit of that history. It's also just so interesting to hear how bringing that information together, getting that clear information, provides that forum for discussion, has allowed countries over time to avoid, as you say, exacerbating market volatility, building confidence. And it's also interesting to hear your point about how spending, a relatively little spending, can make such an important difference in terms of confidence in the market. And when we think about investments in data, I think a good way to frame it is spending to save, because in many cases, you're spending to save money, to avoid waste, but also spending to avoid making bad situations worse, and better targeting resources to where they're needed with good information. And so that's really an important theme here on optimizing the use of data for decision-making. So we're not gonna take questions right away because we are a little short on time because we got started a bit later due to the previous session. But when we do have a moment for Q&A, certainly we'll take any questions folks have for Joe. So we're gonna move now to the next segment of this session. And now what we're going to hear, some inputs from four different data-focused initiatives. I'd ask that all four of our speakers, Vasco, David, Jaron, and Davis, please turn on your videos so that you can be with us. We're hearing from these different initiatives because they do really important work, and it's useful to see this sort of range of work that spans from sort of deep and focused work at country level on country data systems and a kind of global level analytical work that's incredibly important for decision making. I will cut you off. You each have 5 minutes because we are short on time and want to have a little bit of time for questions. So first we'll go to Vasco Malini, the program manager of the 50 by 2030 initiative. Over to you, Vasco, please.
Hi, thank you, Jenna. Thank you to everybody. So as you said, I'm program manager of this initiative, 50 by 30, where 50 stands for 50 country by 2030. The goal is to strengthen the production and utilization of agricultural statistics in these 50 countries, and is a partnership between the World Bank, FAO, IFAD, donors, of course, countries, and in general, civil society, and whoever is interested in this initiative, really to boost this very important goal. Why is it so important, in particular in this moment? Well, if you do a quick overview over many countries in the developing world, you realize that there is a big lack of fundamental, foundational agricultural data. And you wonder how these countries managed so far to develop, monitor, analyze their policies, their agricultural policies. And this evidence becomes even more striking now that we are facing, unfortunately, I mean, another crisis after several others we had before. And this would put really under strain the resilience of many of these countries. And I mean, unfortunately, they haven't prepared for this new crisis because they actually don't know how much they produce, how they produce, how much is their productivity, what kind of soils they are using, and so on and so forth. So, of course, it's not an initiative that reacts to the emergency. I mean, working on data has a long-term impact on the resilience of the countries, but definitely it's something we have to act on now to avoid to repeat another crisis. Unfortunately, we have seen over the last 10 years that crises are repeating and repeating. So if you really want to build some resilience to these shocks that can come from different other sources. I mean, now we have the war, but we have an ongoing crisis that originates from climate change. We definitely have to invest on this statistics infrastructure that will enable countries to develop good quality policies to boost their resilience and address these constant challenges they are facing. Over to you, Jen. I hope I stayed in my time.
That was fantastic, Vasco. I think you characterized the problem very well. And I just think it's great that we have you here with us to emphasize the importance of that foundational data system that all countries need. So now we'll move over to David Laborde, who is a senior research fellow at IFPRI, the International Food Policy Research Institute. David, over to you.
Thank you, Jenna, and thank you everyone for the opportunity to be here. So in 5 minutes, I will cover 5 points, and starting by the fact that in this middle of the crisis, we see a lot of communication and sometimes communication war, when what people need really is information. And actually, there is a process to move from reality to data, and to data to knowledge, and to knowledge to information. So that's where at IFPRI we play a role. Of course, and I will come back on this, we collect some data at IFPRI, but what we do a lot is actually processing and curating some information collected by others in order to make it, more operational for decision making. And for instance, right now there is a lot of uncertainty on the fertilizer market. As Joe has said before, you know, that's not something that AMIS is covering in detail. So we try to fill with this gap with colleagues. But really, that's the time of process. The second point is building all of that actually take times. You know, so people want this information in the middle of the crisis, but collecting the information and processing it, and once again, translating it's something that can be used by a large number of people is a long investment. With Joe, but through the IFPRI channel, since the beginning of this current crisis, we talk about the food security consequences of that. And in order to summarize what is at stake, we came on the day of the invasion with the fact that, you know, 12% of the calories traded globally come from Ukraine and Russia. This number has been used in a lot of places from head of organization up to CNN, number of media. But in order to get this number, actually, we had to combine different data sets, and that's an investment we did starting in 2015 and 16. And we're very happy to have this tool, you know, to summarize a complex story with an accurate number, but something that people can use, because sometimes the complexity of the world can be a bit of overwhelming for both people in the street and people in cabinet. Now, this specific crisis has also shown something else, is it's a crisis on top of a crisis. And COVID-19 itself has been a challenge to collect data, in particular at the household level. So you know how people are vulnerable today. We have to make a number of assumptions. We have to connect dots. We have to reboot some of the data collection process. And that's something we should not forget, you know. And we want also to catch up with the loss of a couple of years of observation we had. But that complexified the current situation. Now, we also have to come with, I would say, new solution. We have to kind of to be agile about how we look at data, how we get access to some of data and real-time data. In the middle of crisis, you know, we cannot just talk about the world how it was 2 years ago. I mean, it's important to know how the world was before major shocks, including COVID, but we need monthly data in terms of for example, trade flows. We need to see, you know, which African country is receiving a shipping of wheat or a shipping of fertilizer in the last couple of weeks or months. And so there is huge investment, I think, to do that. Obviously, right now, we are dealing with a much richer world in terms of data, but some are still, I mean, in the end of the private sector, so they can be costly to access. So really, I think that here there is a kind of thinking because, you know, when you see six or seven organizations, public organizations having to pay the same subscription to a private entity that at the end, or to at the beginning, gets its information from another public entity, I mean, that is how we think about the value chain of information, what is public, what is private. Obviously, the private sector is doing a great job, but really, in order to get access to this live information, we need to rethink some of the channel and solution. And we can discuss this a bit more, you know, where we stand during the Q&A. But for the last 30 seconds I have, I want to say also information for who? I mean, we want information for policymakers, but they are not the only decision makers. Farmers are decision makers. And I think Joe has been very clear that in the US, these needs have been well identified early on, and that's why some countries have invested. But yesterday, you know, I was talking with a woman that is farming in Kenya, and she was telling me the government has not bring us so much information. Even the partners we work with didn't bring us so much information, in particular on the fact that fertilizer price was raising. If you ask me, 1 year ago, we already know that fertilizer price was starting to increase and will continue. This farmer didn't have this information. She was not able to make choice even 6 months ago about what to buy, when to buy, what should be our crop decision, because she didn't know that today fertilizers are very expensive and maybe there will not enough. So, you know, yes, we need to bring this information to policymakers, but we should also think that other actors in the chain are important and we need to reduce the cost of access of information for them and find a good way to deliver it to them. Thank you.
Thank you, David. Those were great points and you stayed within time. So I'm hugely impressed with our first two speakers. And we have a speaker in the panel from the African Women's Agribusiness Network. So on your last point, I think we'll make some connections there. So now over to Jaron Porticello, who is the co-director of an initiative called Series 2030. Over to you, Jaron.
Great. Thank you so much, Jenna. And thank you to everyone for the opportunity to speak today. I'd like to provide a very brief overview of Series 2030, Sustainable Solutions to End Hunger, on behalf of my partners, David Laborde and Karen Smaller. As Jenna said, I'm Jaron Porciello from Cornell University. So just very quickly, I think many of you have heard of Series 2030 before, but we were a donor-driven initiative designed to inform two major questions. First, what are a series of successful interventions that can be used in the international effort to end hunger in a way that also ensures that environmental sustainability is not missed? And then the second question is, what would it cost to implement these interventions and others to end hunger by 2030? So quickly, we produced an evidence-based global roadmap published in the scientific journal Nature of 10 high impact areas and the additional public investment needed to end hunger, double the incomes of smallholder farmers, and protect the climate. Our process to do this was to engage 84 scientists from 23 countries that reviewed more than 100,000 scientific and development papers and data from the past 20 years. And we've been very energized and humbled by the community's response and receptiveness of our findings. This has helped us strengthen our partnership with the donor community and the Global Donor Platform as they've worked strategically, and I think the larger community has worked strategically to move forward a complex agenda to provide sufficient food for all, improve incomes and productivity for small-scale producers, makes diets healthier and more affordable, and build capacities needed to adapt to climate change. So I'd like to now just focus my remarks briefly on some of the themes that the panelists have also raised. So I think in terms of a constellation of partnerships and a deep dive into the research have helped us identify and hone in on a few critical issues surrounding data gaps and the broader evidence landscape that I think we can think through today. So just quickly, for example, the data on gender from across the 100,000 papers that we looked at was not nearly as deep or as complete as we had hoped. Only 1 in 10 papers actually looked at gender as a dimension, and even then, some significant shortcomings were identified. A very specific shortcoming was that most studies only included women when they were actually head of a household. And so this means that women who live in a male-headed household, which is a large majority of women, are not being included in the research and the data, and thus their views were rendered invisible through this particular practice. This limits our ability to draw precise conclusions and recommendations when the literature and the data does not equally represent the challenges and views of women. This is just one example that I wanted to share. There are certainly other noteworthy gaps in the data as well. And given that today's session is really focused on coordination and support and food systems transformation, I want to just spend the last moment addressing these gaps as a bigger picture issue. And so I hope that my partners on the panel today would agree with me when I say that we cannot treat our data and our evidence needs as a short-term goal to only collect the right data. Because ending hunger, I think as we know, requires a portfolio of interventions with significant interplay about what works on the farm, in the market, in a more enabling environment and infrastructure that will empower everyone to succeed. The poorest and the most vulnerable are faced with new and harsh realities that remind us that progress will not be made if ideas are implemented in isolation from each other. And so we cannot collect all the data that we need to fill just one gap or solve it through a one-time project or through a data sprint. A food system transformation requires us to take into account a holistic understanding of how farm production impacts consumer nutrition, how intra-household decision-making impacts climate adaptation, so on and so forth. And so in an era of almost imaginable amounts of data, we need to really nurture a transformation of how we monitor gaps in research and data. As David pointed out, how do we get information to people in real time, in a real way that helps them make a decision? And we need to think through the tools and approaches and platforms that we can create to champion long-term and strategic mechanisms that are designed to build capacity for transforming behavior and practice, not only at the individual level, which is captured when we look through papers and data sets, but also across our organizations and our institutions. And just in closing, I think data in all of its forms, and as we're talking about today, really requires us to build long-lasting and trustworthy partnerships with many different groups and partners and stakeholders along the way. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Jaren. That was great. And it's really great to see the connections across your presentation and David's presentation, how those data gaps create challenges in modeling and predictions at a kind of global level. But the relationship also between getting data to policymakers, getting data to farmers to make decisions, and how gaps like the one on gender impact decisions in a cascading way, why this is such a holistic challenge. So for the last speaker in this segment, we're going to turn to my colleague, Director of Programs for the Global Partnership for Sustainable Development Data, Davis Adiano. And he's going to focus on, we're going to come back to the country level, the work we do across a range of stakeholders to address some of these data challenges. Over to you, Davis.
Thanks so much, Jenna. I come from Kenya, and so when I heard my country being mentioned, I blinked up and I heard what David said, and luckily I can validate what he said as being true. The Global Partnership for Sustainable Development Data is a global network working together to ensure the new opportunities for the data revolution are used to achieve the sustainable development goals. In practically all the countries we work in, agriculture has been prioritized. But as we have heard already, data to support the sector remains a major gap. Where are the farmers? What are they producing? Where are they producing it? Where is it being delivered and managed? Why are people starving when there's certain parts of the country where there's an overproduction and oversupply? So from our experience, governments across the board do recognize the importance of agriculture and food systems as fundamental assets to national well-being, economic development, and prosperity. So there's no doubt about it. The challenge is that food systems overall suffer from, you know, historical and ongoing underinvestments, which is an ironic contradiction from my perspective. You know, the pirated capture of national food systems remains a major barrier. We all know the vulnerabilities that emerge from this really dire situation and the negative impact on livelihoods. You know, people die as a result, and that's the bottom line. So this is much more than just a data conversation. A lot more is actually at stake, and we have to move quickly. We also observe that many countries have very impressive policies and other declarations on paper, and they commit to, you know, regional targets, global targets, but weaknesses in implementation and accountability mechanisms, you know, frustrate commensurate actions that are needed by these governments and other partners to make sure that, commitment is translated into meaningful action. Now, while more and better data is a precondition for more effective policy making and service delivery, including in the agriculture sector, at the GPSDD, we have learned that the relationship between data availability and its actual use is not linear. And of course, you know, donors and multilateral organizations sometimes actually compound this problem by contributing to limiting the long-term impact of national food systems as they favor piecemeal approaches, to particular projects. We've heard from our civil society partners, for example, highlighting misalignment between donor priorities and local priorities when it comes to investing in sustainable food systems. A focus on M&E, as opposed to, investing significant resources in comprehensive and sustainable data systems. So we have to challenge the conversion. There has to be a fundamental shift if we are going to make any progress at all. A revolution of sorts, both in the conversations that are happening, but in the practical approach, in partnerships, resource allocation, strengthening capacity, and much more. So much more needs to be done. And our challenge to you is to apply data and evidence to rethink the way in which projects are actually conceived, are actually funded, and focus on building long-term capacity and trust through technical support, investing much more in building sustainable food systems, through partnerships with local partners and public authorities, but very importantly, with an eye on resilience and long-term impact on citizens. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, Davis. That was a fantastic view from the country level as well. These have just been outstanding and really clear presentations. I wanted to flag, I've just checked that we can allow this session to run a little bit over, maybe by about 10 minutes. We do need to move now to our panel discussion. We have three other speakers. If everyone else can stick around, we'll take all the questions at once. So anyone in the room and online who has questions for any of the speakers, we'll be able to pose them later on in the event. But now we're going to shift to the panel discussion. So I'll ask Beatrice Gacuba, Jose Moncayo, and Conrad Rain, who I think is in the room, to get ready. Beatrice and Jose, if you can put your videos on, I greatly appreciate that. Very much looking forward to our panel discussion today. Seeing our speakers. Do we have them? Great. Here's Beatrice. Wonderful. You'll be our first, Beatrice. So the way we're going to do this is I'm going to ask a couple of questions. Ask you to keep each response. We'll go in turn, each response 3 minutes each. So Beatrice is the executive director of the African Women Agribusiness Network. And to you, Beatrice, first, how can the increased use of data in decision-making support smallholder producers to avert a food crisis in Africa? Over to you, please.
Thank you, Jenna. One Africa is a network that has membership in 44 African countries. We have 3,000 of small scale, medium and large enterprises of women owned and youth owned agribusinesses on the continent and on a digital platform. So obviously we try to use data to deepen our understanding on issues. But I know I have a short time, so I will just speak on what Jaron and David said, which is very important. And first of all, Jaron, I want to echo her. Yeah, there is inequality in the collection of data and the use of data when it comes to women. We know gender inequality is everywhere. And we, as the one, we focus on women in ag. And just to give an example that we really need to reset our methodology when we use the data, you find all of the, you know, like five donors, we go to the same area with the same questionnaire and asking the same women who has no skills in public speaking, who culturally cannot express themselves, who most of the topics they're asking that woman, she doesn't even understand what it is. And really there, I don't think we are working at all. Somebody also mentioned piecemeal. Obviously, each organization going from their own needs without even thinking about I wouldn't say abuse, but it's almost reaching to abuse of that woman in the rural area. And as we know in Africa, 80% of the food we eat is produced by small scale farmers. So if we don't take time to readjust the way we think they function, the way they live in the society and the way they contribute to the whole economy, we won't end hunger. Also, when it comes to, I also speak on the feedback. Somebody mentioned we collect that data for who? There's never a feedback. No one goes back to those ladies and say what it is. And we don't even know if that data we're collecting. The other day we did a small need assessment in the northern of one country, and then, you know, some of our champions said, but WFP was there the other day, and there also was GIZ, and so what? I mean, the same person struggling to do a business without access to finance, trying to, you know, to manage the her business and her family needs for her business, who doesn't even, some of them don't even know how to cost their product, they have no access to financial literacy so they can navigate the financial sector. And we are going there one and on in different steps, in different questions, just for the needs of who, and no feedback to those women. I think we have to coordinate the way we do things. And yes, Jaron and David, Jaron first, we really have now, because we have a platform, we have data, but that data, we don't know why donors are not using it to change the way we design our project and the way we request local and civil organization who implement, who are donor-driven like ours, to say, hey, what is the feedback? What would we be, what is your recommendation to influence the policy? They should be listening to us and getting information to us, because we contextualize, you know? You get another example, just to stop, I will stop there, is you're asking a 45-year woman who has a small farm and who use the profit even she says that she goes and she spends as she needs. And you ask her, where do you want to see yourself in 5 years from now? You don't ask those questions. I mean, she won't even answer, because how can she answer? Yeah. So I think we really have to, it's very important. We need data, and this crisis in Ukraine is, and the war in Ukraine and the impact of the COVID 19 has shown how fragile our food system are. I mean, it was there before, but it has been highlighted. And if we don't really, as the other colleagues also said, our governments, you know, even the donors, even the masters, the data is sitting in the drawers. How do we use that for implementation? I think we need to reconnect our thinking here. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Beatrice. That was a great sort of summary of the challenge faced by smallholders, particularly women in Africa. So with the second question, I wonder, you highlighted a lot of challenges and a lot of sort of needs. So I'm wondering if you can kind of zero in, if there were one or maybe two actions that you think the global donor community should take to address these challenges and strengthen data systems to enable smallholder farmers to make better decisions. What would the one or two actions be, please?
Okay, I think we need the international organization and material to coordinate the activities. Yeah. And then we also need a more serious dialogue on the usage of data, and the feedback is more important. For me, the data collection and is as good as also the feedback to the beneficiaries. We need to listen to them. We need to listen to those organizations on the ground. What do we have to say? What do we have for on those women? What we have their profiles, what they are doing. Why do we go there in there and start questioning them when we have the available? So sharing of information while also we protecting the source of the information, obviously, because that's another question for another time. But we need to coordinate. We don't need all of us to go individually into those to the same people asking the same question without even compensating them for their time, without even recognizing them in our reports for their time. I think there is a lot of things that but most of it coordinating not using data on gender. If we are recognizing that the woman is at the center of the changing the narrative of the food system, then we have to collect more data. Jaron was right. We need to collect more data, and it cannot be just a paragraph on a report. It has to be deep, and we have to come up with adequate and appropriate solutions for that. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Coordination, listening, getting that contextual information, and those feedback loops are incredibly important. As we heard, the data is only as good as it is used, and not just used by policymakers, but used by farmers. But how can farmers make good use of that data if it's not coming back to them? So those were great points. Thank you. So now we'll turn to Jose Rosero Moncayo, who is the director of the Statistics Division at the FAO. Thanks, Jose, for joining us. So the first question to you is, where are the critical gaps for food systems transformation as you see them from where you sit?
Oh, thank you very much, Jenna. Thank you for the invitation. I think that is a very broad question to respond in so few time, because data gaps are many, okay? A monitoring system to track food system transformation needs to be fed by data that address the full spectrum of economic, social, and environmental aspects surrounding food. And indeed, there are important and critical data gaps. So let me refer to some of them. So first, let me stress the point that in order to inform food system transformation, we need to have data that describes what is happening in the whole food value chain. The reality is that the data that currently exists are biased toward what is happening at the farm level. There is relatively speaking, much less information about what is happening in steps such as processing, transformation, distribution, consumption, and waste. And this is, of course, correlated with national data collection processes that are well developed to collect data at farm level and much less developed and much more scarce for the rest of the value chain. Second, let me highlight that geographically speaking, data is more abundant in the high and upper middle income countries, which are the ones that come with highly developed data collection processes. And it is scarce in low and lower middle income countries where data collection that is needed for action find the common obstacles of lack of resources and technical capacities. Third, and this is from the thematical point of view, there is lack of data and indicators that could present, for example, the general picture of food system at national level. So, for example, we don't have a coordinated effort to compute and monitor the contribution of food systems to the economy or to economic growth. Again, we know how much agriculture contributes to GDP at national level, but if we would like to add to this contribution, the contribution of the rest of the sectors involved in food systems, like the industry, transportation, commerce, accommodation, et cetera, the exercise is more cumbersome, and the data is normally presented not at the level of disaggregation that is needed to compute this type of, an overall indicator that relates to the entire food system. Another example comes from data on population participating in food systems. ecosystem activities. Here the gaps are even there, but not even the population participating in agriculture is measured accurately, as most of these activities in low-income countries are informal, and with the participation of several unpaid family members that are not well going from the specific areas or dimensions of the system, there are vital gaps, for example, in the social dimension of livelihoods, poverty, and equity. Here, we don't have an indicator that can accurately measure poverty in the rural sector. A multidimensional measure is better suited than monetary measures to speak about the specificities of the rural sector, but current data collection systems do not provide all the data that is required. We have also gaps, important gaps in the diet and nutrition domain. And there is little consensus about indicators that go beyond the indicator that relate to supply and index of certain foods and that actually can measure the quality of diets. There are also gaps to measure food loss and waste, which is important, of course, to in terms of efficiency and sustainability of food systems. But with all of this, my intention, and with this I end, is not to say that the task of monitoring food system transformation is doomed, not at all. I am part of a group of people that believe that there is data already available to make our best to build a monitoring system at national, regional, and global level. In this sense, actually, the main critical gap is the lack of a consent, clear, rigorous, and comprehensive set of available metrics to monitor systematically food system transformation and guide decision makers. And on this, international organizations and academia can help a lot, systematizing what is available in a way to propose a set of indicators that can be used as a reference for monitoring the process of food system transformation. Over.
Thanks so much, Jose. That was a great rundown. I acknowledge that we gave you a very difficult and broad question to answer in a short period of time, but you did a great job. That was an excellent rundown and a good note of optimism on the end. So the second question is, what do you see as the role of UN agencies, and in particular the FAO, in optimizing the use of data for food systems transformation and responding to the food crisis?
Thank you, Jenna. As said, a critical gap, okay, is the lack of rigorous mechanism to track food system transformation that is based on a comprehensive framework of available metrics. And that is exactly where international bodies such as FAO and also academia can contribute, partnering to establish an indicator framework based on what science can tell us are the best indicators we can use from the pool of existing available data. And with this in mind, let me give you a concrete example on how such a collaborative effort is put in motion. So with the aim of filling the aforementioned gap, FAO has partnered with Johns Hopkins University and with the Global Alliance for Improved Nutrition Gain in 2021 to create the so-called Food System Countdown Initiative. This is an unparalleled partnership and collaboration with the participation of more than 50 scientists from nearly 30 academic institutions, non-governmental organizations, and UN agencies from nearly all continents. Now, what the Food System Countdown Initiative is proposing is an independent tracking and assessment system for food systems based on a curated and parsimonious set of relevant, high-quality, interpretable, and useful indicators centered around five thematic areas that are related to, first, diet, nutrition, and health; second, environment and climate; third, livelihoods, poverty, and equity; fourth, governance; and fifth, resilience and sustainability. So during this year, okay, 2022, these 50 and plus collaborators have worked on selecting a list of indicators that follow criteria such as, first, feasibility, meaning that recent data exists, normally defined as having at least one data point collected in the last 10 years, and that there are also a plan to update this over the next 8 years. Second is coverage, meaning that data exists for at least 70 countries. And third, transparency, meaning that no indicators are calculated with undisclosed modeling methodologies or assumptions. So the list of indicators that has been put together has been validated, as we speak, by two mechanisms: an expert consultation, and second, a series of regional consultations. We have made 5 regional consultations among users related to policy making. So the initiative expects to have, until the end of the year, a final list of indicators in all the dimensions that can be used as a reference for countries that would like to monitor food system transformation and assess the impact of the actions proposed in their country national pathways. And at the same time, the initiative expects to deliver an annual assessment of the state of global food systems and their transformation. In 2022, the initiative will prepare a first assessment of the state of global food systems, which will serve as a baseline for monitoring progress and potentially, that is what we also want to pursue, to measure performance. So this is a very concrete way that in which we can optimize the use of data currently available to inform food system transformation and promote action, which become even more relevant in the context of crisis and conflict like the one that we are living nowadays. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Jose. That was great and wonderful to hear about that initiative. It sort of responds to a number of the themes here around coordinated support, collaboration, building on data that exists and kind of streamlining support. So now on that theme, we're going to turn to our final speaker in this panel, Conrad Rain, Policy Officer from the European Commission Directorate General for International Partnerships, and to bring a donor perspective. So Conrad, to you, what are the key challenges that donors face in coordinating their support for investments in data and data systems at both national and global levels? So thinking a little bit about what we've heard from Beatrice and the other speakers for national level and the kind of global level coordination challenges that, that Jose was highlighting, please.
I believe the main challenge is certainly not the lack of data in general. I think there's plenty of data available with an increasing ease of access. The challenges actually, in my view, relate more to the timeliness and right frequency of the data, as well as with their transformation into transparent and usable indicators, also what Jose was referring to, that enable donors and policymakers to make evidence-based decisions. And as COVID and the ongoing war have shown us, we needed rapidly, quickly available information that only became available slowly, actually, at the end of the day. And as Vasco was saying, in order to become resilient on these shocks, we need to invest in data. Yeah, over to you, Jenna.
Great, thank you. So perhaps with these challenges that you've identified, can you tell us how you think these challenges can be overcome by the European Commission and the broader donor community?
Yes, I believe we need to invest more in data. I mean, there's no doubt in this. And we as EU, I will give you three ongoing examples that we are at present funding. One is the 50 by 2030 initiative that we support with 5 million, and Vasco was speaking about that. Another project is actually managed by Jose's division. It's on strengthening in statistical offices. And the third one is, and we are actually a very long-term supporter of this program, is the food security portal, which is managed by IFPRI. And those of you who are not aware of this food security portal, just a little background info. It was developed after the 2007-2008 food price shocks. And the EU, again, as I said, is a long-standing supporter. In fact, now we are preparing the fourth phase to support this portal. And it's actually not only a website, it's also a portal that facilitates, that organizes seminars, especially in sub-Saharan Africa, and tries to influence decision-making also at a quite senior level. So it's not only a website, and it is a very, very important program for us. And I think this portal played a key role in the context of COVID-19 and also the war, where, as I said, data was not quickly enough made available. But let's just take COVID-19, when some countries started to implement export restrictions, then the work of the portal and the tools that were developed by the food security portal, they contributed actually that these restrictions were lifted. And now also on the war, the portal is extremely active with giving data. And this is very important that for an institution like the European Commission to have reliable data and to be accountable. Of course, we have to be accountable towards taxpayers, civil society, etc. And And we need reliable data. We need data that is constantly updated. That's, you know, frequency is an important issue. So it is one example, and the two other ones I mentioned already, and we heard about it, and I'm happy to take questions on these. In general, monitoring, analysis, early warning dimensions are all very important and for us. Thank you.
Thank you, Conrad, for that. So now we have, well, we have 15 minutes on our regularly scheduled time. We may be able to bleed over the hour a little bit if there are a lot of questions. We had a number of really compelling and interesting speakers. And I would open the floor and ask that anybody in room or on Zoom using the chat function puts their question in. Henry, I'll also ask for your help to highlight if there's anybody raising their hand in the room to direct, and please be specific about which speaker you'd like to direct your questions to. The floor is open.
Can I just jump in?
Yes, please.
Do you hear me? Okay, yes. Great. My name is Frank from GIZ, and I think I have the most obvious question for all the different initiatives presented. How do you coordinate among yourselves? Is there a kind of more comprehensive data architecture you're looking at?
That's a great question, but it's going to be hard to direct to anyone. So maybe what I'll do is I'll start, maybe we'll hear from, for example, from Jose sitting at FAO. You're at the center of a lot of different initiatives, including academia, other UN agencies and the like. And so maybe we can hear a little bit from you, Jose, on how you facilitate coordination.
No, thank you. Thank you. So yeah, I can give it a try. So, I mean, what the person that raised the question, sorry that I didn't get your name, has raised is very important, okay? Because we want to believe that the different initiatives that we are implementing have certain level of coordination. Actually, they are designed to achieve a much comprehensive and bigger role, okay? So let me give you from the perspective of the FAO Statistics Division what we are doing. And you heard one of these initiatives that was presented by Vasco. So as FAO, we are partners of the 50 by 2030 initiative. As FAO is the institution that is in charge of the data production component. And we're implementing that initiative together with other initiatives, such as the what it is called the Global Partnership, the Global Strategy for Improving Agricultural and Rural Statistics. Okay, how do we connect both of them? We connect the both of them from the point of view that the Global Strategy project is basically one that has the objective to build the fundamentals, okay, the fundamental capacities of the countries in order to be able to produce agricultural statistics. Well, the 50 by 2030 initiative is a little bit beyond the fundamentals, right? In order to collect agricultural surveys, you need to have already overcome certain fundamental limitations that you had, okay, in order to be able to get some kind of system to collect data, okay? So we have the both of them connected. So countries start, especially the ones in which basically there are no capacities, and we have many in sub-Saharan Africa. They start with a global strategy. We build capacities, okay? For example, capacities in sampling, in collecting surveys, in using devices to collect data, et cetera, and et cetera. At the moment that they are ready, okay, they are able to graduate from the global strategy and go to the 50 by 2030 initiative. At the same time, we have another initiative. Let me go very briefly on this. That is what we call, what is basically what Conrad referred to, because we have support of the European Commission on this. that is basically what we call internally the Voice of the Hungry project, that has the objective to try to strengthen the capacities of the country level in order to collect data on food security statistics. And here we are talking about chronic food insecurity measures that are part of the SDG indicators. In the same way, we try to more or less target countries that have that do not have the capacity to collect themselves, but of course that they have potential to do it, okay? And we try to connect them as well with the Global Strategy project. Over to you, Gina.
Thanks, Jose. That's that was really great and helpful. Please, Joe, come in.
Yeah, no, I just wanted to mention a couple of things following on Jose's comments. And that is AMIS, by its nature, is sort of a coordinating body. And so we have tried, I think, particularly, I think, since the over the last few years, and I would say in particular with the crisis in Ukraine, have tried to maintain some consistency in terms of response across agencies. And as I say, we have several organizations, including FAO, including WFP and EFAD and others who are part of the Secretariat for AMIS. And I highlight something like export restrictions. It was mentioned in the food security portal, and my colleague David Laborde, actually, who's on our panel, has developed a export or a tracker for export restrictions that the food security portal uses, and we've used at IFPRI a lot. And we, as at AMIS, we coordinated a workshop where others who are also tracking those export restrictions, like the WTO, like OECD, like UNCTAD, and others, were able to get together and talk from a technical standpoint about what each other are doing. And I think that's been very, very useful. And again, as I say, and just to echo what Jose was saying, I think it's very, very important so that we don't have 7 or 10 different IOs talking with different numbers and different interpretations of data, that we do have some sort of, I mean, don't get me wrong, differing points of view are really important, but the point is to bring them into a discussion and to hopefully come to some understanding of each other, where these data are coming from. Thanks.
Thanks so much, Joe, and for emphasizing that point. I think this kind of having that dialogue and finding that common ground so that everyone's speaking from sort of the same song sheet, but after sort of rigorously assessing the different pieces and analysis that are coming from different sources is incredibly important, and different methodologies, et cetera. I don't see any hands, but I'd like to actually come back to David and Jaron because of some of the points you made in response to some of the points that Beatrice made. I'd like to pose a question because David, you made the point not just about decision-making for who, you made the point about policymakers and farmers. And Jaron, you highlighted this, the holistic nature of strengthening food systems and the data that underpins food systems. And I'm wondering if each of you can share with you one thought on what you think the sort of donor community can do to avoid the sort of duplication and piecemeal approach that Beatrice was highlighting is felt very viscerally at the country level, and thinking about the data that are needed by farmers. Now that we've heard this really important point about a kind of international coordination across international organizations. So I'll go to Jaron first and then David, please.
Right. No, thanks, Jenna. And thanks to all of the speakers for the remarkable interventions today. It's really been a pleasure to listen to everyone. So, Jenna, where I'm going to narrow down and sort of zoom into this is I'm going to speak maybe from the perspective of research and academia, right? Just to kind of put this in context. I mean, I think we know that science has an essential role to play in informing agriculture and food systems policies. But as Joe was just referring to, how do we kind of bring levels of coordination into play? I'm gonna throw out just a couple of quick statistics. So there is a new peer-reviewed research article that's published every 20 seconds in the sciences across thousands of different journals. And so it's always an interesting question to me when we talk about the gaps that we have in data and research, yet we're sitting on almost an unimaginable amount of data. This really gets to the question, I think, of data reuse, data use, and then further data reuse. what kind of coordinated systems do we actually need to be able to make use of this volume of information in a meaningful way? And I know that we in agriculture, and I've worked in international agriculture for the past 15 years, I know that we don't like to be compared to the health sciences community, and that's for very good reason. We have, you know, different data, we have different needs, but I do think that there are some opportunities for us to think about levels of coordination based on what they've done in the health sciences and the medical community for the past 20 years. And I think that they have recognized the importance of being able to translate research findings into evidence and establishing different systems to prioritize, synthesize, and disseminate evidence-based information. And so, you know, the most obvious example for me to point to here is the Cochrane community, which is a resource that really guides coordinated, you know, evidence and evidence dissemination. At this point, more than 90% of WHO guidelines are backed by some type of a Cochrane study or Cochrane recommendation. And while this is not the be-all, end-all, it does provide a platform, some tools, and capacity building in order for people to be able to make or find information that has been coordinated, collated, and collected. And so this is one example that I think we can think about as a community, and recognizing that it did not sprout up overnight. It took more than 20 years to establish something like this, but it is still going strong. And so when we think about levels of coordination, I think it definitely takes more than excellent goodwill, collaboration, and communication. I think it does require us to think seriously about our methodologies, our approaches, and how we're actually asking people to come together and collaborate and share. So I leave it there and pass over to David. Thank you.
Thanks, over to you, David.
Yes, I think this question of actually centralizing information about which data is collected where and by who is currently missing. So that leads to this duplication and inefficiency. And sometimes you will see two cases where you have five organizations that publish five times some numbers, but all these numbers come from the same source. So actually there is no really value addition in that. Or at the opposite right now, you will find five, seven organizations collecting the price of wheat, let's say in Dar es Salaam. And at the same time, we don't have the price of sweet potato. And what we really need is complementarity. So having a first initiative and potentially through the Global Alliance for Food Security that is starting now to make sure that we have one depository or repository with a catalog of what is going on already. And when founders come with additional money, that we target gaps and not duplication, but we are also sure that some initiative have a lifetime in the future, because sometimes we have something in 3 months, it's going to be discontinued. So really we need to navigate that. And obviously FAO that has an important role here to centralize this. Maybe FAO will not have to collect everything, but at least that we have, you know, one place and we know, okay, WFP is collecting this in that place. But also there is a number of NGOs that are collecting information that right now is not well integrating within the UN statistical system. And so there is some dots to connect and a proper inventory work to do. But I would say that we're still in a much better place today than 10 or 15 years ago. A lot of progresses have been made, and that's why investment pay off, but we just need to continue this and act in a coordinated way to avoid wasting resources for the donors, and also this statistical fatigue that people can see and can face. And I think also, as Jose has said, to not forget that it's not just the farm level that matters. We have also other place along the value chain that we need to start to collect more information on. And that's very important for all the actors within this food system.
Thank you so much, David. That was really useful input. So I'm just going to pause now, ask Henry if we have any hands up in the room, or anyone who wants to come in the room. And if anyone listening in wants to put any final questions in the chat, I'll just pause a moment.
Well, Jenna, I think you can see me. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. Thank you.
I'm looking at my colleagues who've been engaged meaningfully throughout the day. If they're feeling a little bit short of energy, don't worry, we can soon revive them. We need some carbohydrate, a bit of glucose, a bit of IFAD nourishment, let's see. because they've been focused on what you've been saying. It's been a wonderful virtual panel, and obviously Conrad here in situ. But do we have a little supplementary comment or a question before I hand back to Jenna? Come on, people, show our virtual people what the three-dimensional people are made of. Let's have a look. Yes, please let us know who you are. And I think your camera is, are we on camera two, camera three? Is it that one there? Yes, I think it's that one.
Hello. So my name is Manon Bellon and I'm from France.
Yes, hello.
Thank you for laying the floor. I just wanted to complete this very rich discussion by a question about new kind of data. Do you see a need for new kinds of data of data collection as well, mainly to be able to target smallholders? And I'm specifically looking at Beatrice Gakuba here. Do you have from the fields, from your network, any needs that are not targeted by those questionnaires you spoke of? Thank you.
A new kind of data or data. Jenna, let's see, Jenna, before we hand over to you and Beatrice, if we have a supplementary question, because I suspect there may be one, given the quality of contributions we've had so far today. Yes.
Yeah, my question would be, how do you organize data collection for countries where we have physical access to fields or people?
Again, sorry?
How do you organize data collection in countries where we have physical access to people or to fields?
Okay, so Jenna, and that question came from Madame Shilombo, who represents the
Congo DRC.
That's right, Congo DRC, the Office of the Presidency, no
less. Exactly, yes.
That's right. Okay, so Jenna, we have two questions. Back to you.
Great, thank you. Maybe I'll ask Beatrice to respond to the first, and I'll ask Davis to respond to the second, seeing as how our team works across many different countries with many geographical challenges and limitations. Beatrice, over to you.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Manon, for raising that question. Yes, we do need a new sets of data collection, especially when we with regards to the women small scale farmers, producers, even aggregators. Yeah, we in 2020 October we did an impact assessment on our network on the impact of COVID. To our members, and actually, some of the interesting finding that we have not seen any other organization really trying to fit into their policy. We hope is coming, is that, you know, 80% of our women lost income, who are, you know, the businesses, their business, because during the confinement and the restriction of movement, they had to stay home to take over the roles that were played by women just because they were women. They had to be teachers, because for those who are lucky to be in town to, you know, to deliver their trainings online for their children. And also they didn't have any house help, because some of the house help wanted to go up country where they come from, so they can be restricted there where they could have access to food, right? So there were some highlighted, some, as we said earlier, which I think John also said, that there was just particular data that is really related to the role of the woman in the product, you know, or sector. I'm of course focusing on agribusiness and care, but we've got to narrow down on that one. What is that that we are overlooking, and that is inhibiting women to grow their business? Because everywhere for the last 20 years, we're talking about, you know, the informal sector, but even those in the formal, what is the profile of the young woman today? 40% of our network is made of under 35 years old. Those are the young girls who have left university, who have a degree, who have no jobs and have gone back to agriculture. They bring in knowledge, they bring in, you know, access to digitalization, which is another challenging issue. So we will need really to at least to, you know, to be able also to be given resources to go into that collection of that data that is particular to women. Yeah. that, and you know, when you compare to their male counterparts, that is missing. And obviously that's why we are not progressing so much, because you cannot ignore 50% of the population. You cannot ignore 80% of the people we are feeding. I give an example that is relating to my last one, to this, the crisis in the food, oil, and fertilizers. We have young people who came up with innovative ideas of making bread with local cereals and tubers and et cetera. Actually, you know, to mitigate the shortage of wheat and everything. And we are not really going after them and saying what made them shift. What was the response? When we ask online how they came up with those innovations, they said, "Oh, we saw it on TV." For those who have TV, yeah, we saw it in the news and we saw also the price that was going up. And we said, "We have our own local cereals. Why can't we just make bread with our own local cereals?" Right. So those are the innovations that come to mitigate the global crisis, but we're not documenting them because we don't have resources to go and deep. What prompts this? You know, in the lack of guidance and the use of data to prevent and to prepare, the lack of preparedness for our small, medium, and small scale businesses, those shocks that they don't even understand, right? Because no information is like to them. I agree with, you know, we really need a new set of also data, and not necessarily new data, but some questionnaires. When we design questionnaires, those are particular for women. We have to pay attention to that.
Thank you, Beatrice. Thank you so much. So now we are running out of time, and I know even some colleagues have to depart to go back to the council meeting, which is ongoing. We had a question about organizing data collection at country level, particularly where there are maybe geographic challenges. Let's hear a minute or so from Davis on that. And actually, I'd like to, for a last word, bring in Vasco Molini on that from the 50 by 2030 initiative, given the work they're doing at country level as well. And then we'll wrap up. So over to you, Davis.
Thank you. And I think this links to the question on new sources of data. It is actually possible right now with the emergence of ICTs, communication technologies, to have new complementary sources of data really support existing statistical services. We have Earth observations data, which now from the comfort of your room, through the use of data science skills, algorithms, can help you to understand, which crops are being grown where, what is the coverage, what's the amount of water, what's the rainfall patterns in that particular region. So these new complementary sources of data are really important. The second opportunity is the use of citizen-generated data. With mobile phones, those are really powerful tools. There's a lot of applications that are being developed by citizens that can help, identify crop diseases, for example. It is possible now to have frameworks for data sharing between, local communities and agriculture offices. And we've seen this in Ghana and in other places where social enterprises are creating frameworks that enable, smallholder farmers to actually share data with the Ministry of Agriculture, and for the Ministry of Agriculture to share data with smallholder farmers in a timely manner. I think what is really important in a context where there's difficulties in infrastructure, in collection of data, is investing in infrastructure that allows for the sharing of data. And I think digital technologies can come in very handy, and the use of these emerging technologies that I'm talking about. The second one is I would say in a difficult context is also partnerships between local communities and governments, because one of the things that tends to happen is you need data, somebody else has the data, they've been collecting it for a long time, but that data is not being shared. So can we start by sitting on the table, as different actors, and identifying opportunities for collaboration, identifying opportunities, in terms of where the data actually is, and looking at specific indicators that can then be shared across civil society, donors, government, and others. And the last one is, of course, governments have to proactively, think about critical investments, long-term sustainable investments in ensuring that data collection methodologies actually achieve the coverage that is actually desired. In the absence of that, you know, you can talk about, you know, access to data, but it's still quite difficult for many others, to achieve this. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Davis. And for the last minute or so, Vasco, we'll give you the last word, sure. Please.
So 50 by 30 initiative has a dedicated unit that looks at the new methodologies and tries to basically adapt new methodologies. I mean, discussion that are ongoing at the university level, and tries to simplify them and make them usable by statistical offices. I mean, the clear example is, for example, satellite images. Nowadays in conflict-affected countries, I mean, where big chunk of the country is inaccessible, using satellite images certainly represent an important solution. The problem is that often these technologies are particularly sophisticated and complicated, and the capacity at Ministry of Agriculture, statistical office level is not there to take advantage of these big opportunities offered by technology. So, for example, our method and tools team is developing a guideline, okay, a manual on how to use this. And of course, that then you need also to support countries in the implementation of these guidelines. So there is a big potential, I would say, but the risk is that it remains untapped if there is no linkage, no, between all this knowledge that is out there and the capacity to exploit it. Okay. And I think we can overcome many of the problems posed by, I don't know, conflict and a lack of accessibility, but also costs. No, I mean, satellite images can also reduce the costs of data collection. But clearly, you really need to work hard on this link between what is there and how countries can take advantage of that. Over.
Thank you so much, Vasco, for rounding us out. And thank you to everyone for this incredible discussion today. This was really an incredibly rich discussion. Thanks for all your patience and going a little bit over because we started late. I won't attempt to perfectly summarize, but there are a few points that really jumped out at me. One was the emphasis on coordination, particularly for the international community, the global donor community, and not just coordination in general, but specifically to figure out how to build on what exists and fill gaps where we're missing important data and information. The second is the point about staying the course, that individual projects and piecemeal efforts are doing a disservice to the real needs at country level and in terms of global coordination. The third was one about multi-level interventions. This discussion today had mixed perspectives from the needs at the global level in terms of policy coherence and coordination and the specific needs at country level and down to the level of farmer. And we need multi-leveled interventions when it comes to supporting data systems. And lastly, the importance of dialogue and partnership. Dialogue for validating information and finding discrepancies and settling on a common number rather than using multiple measures of the same indicator, and partnerships that allow for leveraging technology and multiple data sources and facilitating access and sharing of data. And lastly, I'll just end with one final thought, and that is, I think we've heard very much today that investments in data are spending to save. It creates efficiencies, better targeting, better information, so that we can respond to crises and implement programs and policies that will affect food systems transformation. So thanks so much to all our speakers. That was really incredible. And thank you all for your time. Back over to you, Henry.
Jenna, thank you very much for a very effective and smooth chairing. And thank you to all your wonderful panelists. Please put your hands together. Fantastic panel. Hope you can hear it and feel it out there looking at you. That was wonderful. Thank you very much indeed. And Jenna rounded off her session so effectively. I mean, many of the points that she raised for data were just as pertinent to the sessions we've had this morning onwards, you know, from the scene-setting keynote by Excellency Mukeshimana from Rwanda. And then, of course, we've got the CGIR, a keynote from Dr. Sadoff, and then finding out about the food systems hub from the UN. That's from Dr. Fotiu, should I say. And I'm really, really pleased with the breadth and the variety of what we've done today, particularly with that opening panel with the three country conveners from Yemen, Cambodia, and Colombia. And yeah, that energy was taken on into the breakout rooms. And I thought people came back and fed back very effectively. And I'm delighted that we had our panel, which was able to digest and distill what was discussed there and synthesize to leave us with some tangibles, which is excellent. And then of course we went to data. So I'm not gonna go through everything. I thought before I look ahead to tomorrow, that I would be remiss if I didn't pivot back to a guy, a gentleman, who has helped win a variety of ways in preparing this event today. And of course, doing the white paper and the stock taking exercise, Dr. Jim Woodhill, who is a special advisor to the GDPRD. I think most of you know him. I was wondering, Jim, given that you were quite instrumental with Rocio and the team in conceiving of this, how do you feel we've done today? Because remember what we wanted to get to, we wanted to make some genuine, tangible progress, you know, because let's remember the overarching theme here, supporting national food systems, transformation, pathways. It's about donor effectiveness and coordination at country level in times of crisis. And God knows we're going through crises around the world at the moment. How have we done?
Wow. I mean, I think we've done fantastically. I mean, it's really been very, very interesting to hear all of the different perspectives today, but I think super valuable to hear the country perspectives.
Yes.
And I think the underlying message from today is that these national country pathways are critically important. Mm-hmm. I don't think there's been much doubt left around that. And I think the thing that I've found super encouraging is to hear that there is actually progress. Things are happening there. So I think some of us might have wondered, we had the Food System Summit last year, is stuff happening? And I think from all of the countries we've heard from today, yes, it is definitely happening. And I think countries are seeing it as important. And I think a really interesting part of that is this sense that the whole food systems framing really is somewhat of a different paradigm. And it challenges us in all sorts of different ways. It puts extra pressure on the coordination issue, but it really is shifting things in a different way. And I think it was really interesting to hear from a number of the countries, how these national pathways are being integrated into real cross-ministry work, mm-hmm. getting leadership from the top levels of the countries. I think one of the really important things that we're hearing as well is these pathways aren't about pieces of paper. I think they're about a process. They're about bringing people together over and again, discussing issues, getting to the hub of the detail of it. And I think in this last session just now, talking about the data, if we don't have the data, we don't know what the issues are. Yeah. We don't have the data, we don't know what progress we're making. And if we don't have the data, we can't explain to people what the longer term consequences of not taking action will be. I think we've also heard a whole range of different leverage points, if you like, that are really important in taking the national pathways forward. And I'm not going to try to go over those again, no, but no. As the GDRP, we've been writing a whole list of those things. I think it does all of this put tremendous expectations back on the donor community.
Yep.
So there's a lot of thinking that needs to go on there. Of course, we're living in a rather difficult world at the moment, as we all know. But I think that means that actually coordination, getting people together, working on these challenges in an integrated and coordinated way is as important as ever, despite the difficulties. And I think giving each other encouragement. I mean, really exciting to hear what is going on despite all the difficulties in the world. So I think we should go away encouraged, but realizing there's still a big job ahead of us.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Jim. Come on. Thank you very much, Jim. Wonderful. So to continue my athletics metaphor, we've gone through that difficult third lap. We're now down the home straight. The arms have got to go up. The knees have got to go high. So we keep going because tomorrow is going to be just as exciting. We're going to be back here in time for 9 o'clock. Well, you can have coffee at 8:30 if you're feeling strong and you manage to avoid all the temptations of Trastevere and all these beautiful parts of Rome when you hang out this evening. Beautiful temperatures outside, 31, 32 degrees. My God, they call Rome the eternal city. Isn't it great to be here? Now, also, so tomorrow morning, this is something that was hinted at earlier on in one of the sessions. Land, responsible land-based investing, especially when there are tensions on the ground. We all talk about, and sometimes we glorify the indigenous communities, but sometimes people pay lip service to them. We say they're custodians of the knowledge, but when it comes to push, they're the first ones out. Their voice is often ignored. So tomorrow morning from 9 o'clock, we've got a nice big session, responsible land-based investing as strategy to mitigate harms of new food crisis. So we've got a panel there and we'll have Q&A and hopefully lots of good engagement there. Really, really important topic. We actually discussed that in the FAO World Forestry Congress in Seoul a few weeks ago. Very important there. And then this is also critical, and we've done a lot of preparation for this next one. At 11, rural youth employment. Didn't we say today, we've got to persuade the youth who are often engines of dynamism that there is a future, not just a fallback option to staying in rural areas, but there are real opportunities and they can be the catalyst for so much transformation. So at 11, rural youth employment and food systems transformation in times of multiple crisis. And then at 1, and please stay for this, a special high-level session, building consensus and coordination on current global crisis response. We've got a big, strong panel there as well, including, and one or two to be confirmed, but we're going to have a high-level speaker from USAID, I think, possibly Jim Barnard, I think he's going to be with us. Fantastic. And then Beth Dunford, Vice President for Agriculture, Human and Social Development, the African Development Bank, who've just had their annual meetings in the Ghana capital, Accra. You don't say Accra, Accra, with a longer Accra, I will say, okay. Otherwise, the Ghanaians will finish me off. And then we've also got Sebastian Lesch, Head of Division, Sustainable Agricultural Supply Chains at the BMZ, the German Federal Ministry for Economic Cooperation and Development, and Dr. David Nabarro, UN Global Crisis Group Food Workstream Co-Lead and Strategic Director of 4SD. We've got a good 7 or so panelists there, but there's some of them. So I hope you will grace us with your presence tomorrow. Whatever you get up to this evening, make it clean and sustainable. And be, if I'd compliant, when you come back tomorrow morning. In the meantime, though, I say God bless you and have a wonderful evening. Thank you very much indeed.